Hi, Dorothy.
Hi, Dorothy.
All right, so we were talking about vocalises. And we've been talking about the muscle activation thing and so on, you know, which direction you go and how that's going to affect, you know, adding a little more weight or top down would be keeping you lighter, the tissue fatigue. We talked about the things that really tire our lamina propria, that outer layer of the vocal folds, high, loud, for a long period of time. And the other thing that can be fatiguing to it is doing tons and tons of like staccato, you know, because it's just lots of onsets. So we have to be careful of asking too much of some of those kind of tasks at a time, and thinking in terms of the pacing of a vocalizing session with a student, those are more sophisticated things, you know, singing full out, doing staccati or the mezza di voce and things. Those are things we're going to do probably later after the person's had a little while to kind of get rolling. The motor learning things, which we're going to delve into a little bit more here. Are you after immediate performance or are you after learning? Because the things that tend to enhance immediate performance suppress learning and vice versa. There's the psychological thing of you know, we talked about the situation of where you're meeting with a student right before they're going to go out and sing their senior recital or something like that. And they said, could you please warm me up, you know, whatever. And like, sure, I just offer. I always just offer because it's just a time for me to be reassuring with them and to make sure that, you know, they don't try to do something that's going to set them up wrong, you know, for the beginning of the recital. Sometimes the grad students are like, I'm good, you know, and it's just leave them alone, you know. And or if somebody says, no, I really rather do it myself, cool. But oftentimes if I just offer, you know, hey, would you like me to warm you up before your recital? They're like, yes, please. So that finding the right things that help the person get the best balance of they're getting challenged and they're also getting some of that, hey, I can do this. And then the musical factors, you know, does it transfer to the piece you're working on? So if you got a piece that's got lots of things where you have like a little run and then skips, then you might devise some exercises that have things like that, like a da 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 dum bum 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 bum, you know, little patterns like that. Okay, so today, then, what we're going to do is look at some and talk about, well, what is that doing? Okay? So you can see the pattern there. Booty, 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 boo. Okay? Let's try singing it. Here we go. When you do the ooh, yeah, that's a little lengthening, yeah. Catherine, anything?
don't know.
Okay, what did it feel like?
Very relaxing.
Okay, relaxing's cool. Sarah?
I felt like I was tempted to not sing like a true E.
Right.
Like it was pulling
me away
from it, and I wanted to sing ooh E, ooh E.
Yeah.
E.
Although I heard all of you modifying as we started to take it a little higher. Okay, so let's talk about the consonants. What do you see with the consonants? They are voiced or unvoiced?
It's a mixture, isn't it?
B,
it's a voiced,
d,
and then
b,
unvoiced.
D, b, d. They're b, b, d, d.
Oh, yeah.
They're both voiced. Okay, what kind of consonants are they? Bb and dd.
Are they both plosives?
They're both plosives. So they're both voiced plosives. And wonderful thing about the voiced plosives, about the plosives in general, is in order to articulate the consonant, to build up that little bit of pressure in your mouth for just a second, something magic has to happen in the back of your mouth. Magic. You get like two for the price of one. Your palate goes up. Because you can't, because if you don't have your palate up, we get mmm instead of b. B, mmm. If your palate's down, we'd get a mmm. Moo, boo. Moo, boo. Moo, boo. Feel that? Okay. How about knee, d, knee, d, knee, d. Now that makes you aware of there's not the pressure when you're doing the nasal. There is that little pressure and release when you do the plosive. So the plosives are groovy for reminding soft palate, hey, hey, stay up, stay up. Okay, what about the vowels? What kind of vowels are they?
They're closed.
They're closed. So they have low first formants. Okay. Our mouth is closed. And if we were classifying the oo, what's an oo? Is it front, back, or mixed?
Typically a back vowel.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. So oo is a back vowel. Even though it feels very front, because we have a small mouth opening, yeah. But it's classified as a back vowel because of tongue position. Okay, and then E is a, what kind of vowel? Front, back, or mixed? Front. So you've got a back vowel and a front vowel.
Which is why it was hard to make E, as we wanted E to be.
Yeah, so we're pairing those two up, which might keep the oo from being too dark and the e from being too e, you know. So by doing some alternating back and forth, we're trying to find that not too dark, not too bright, but just right. It's that Goldilocks place. Still distinct from each other, but trying to get that nice chiaroscuro that we like to talk about. Okay, so we've talked about consonants, and we've talked about vowels. What about the pattern? Conjunct or disjunct?
Conjunct,
right. It's just right down a scale. So it's a scale-wise conjunct pattern, and it's descending. Okay.
I felt like I would have more anxiety had it been ascending.
Yeah. Booty, 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 booty. Yeah, maybe. Do you think men or women or both for this exercise? Both. I wouldn't have women doing it screechingly high. Mm-hmm. When in a warm-up might you do this, or a vocalizing session?
Beginning.
Yeah, I think so. At the beginning, number one, it's descending, which is a nice thing to kind of start with, you know, where you're bringing lighter voice down. And the closed vowels kind of cold turkey you into singing lighter, you know? Yes, ma'am.
So would you call something like this a vocalese or a warm-up? Are all warm-ups vocalises used at a different time of the practice?
Well, you could use vocalises in a warm-up.
Okay. What's the difference between... Oh, I mean, I know what's the difference between the
vocalizing,
time,
yeah.
Like,
yeah.
What's the difference between the actual exercises?
Call them exercises then, if that's, you know, if that's easier. Call them vocal exercises that you could use in a vocalizing session, or you could use in just a warm-up. Certainly the first pattern or two that you do in a big 30 minutes of vocalizing or whatever is going to be functioning as your warm-up, getting you going, whether it's lip trills or, you know, sighs or sirens or something like this. Yeah, so. Something that you guys, as more advanced singers, would do like, no big deal, I might not do that second or third. That might be the last thing for a freshman, you know, because that's their really challenging exercise they're working on. Okay, so let's do another one. Did you guys write up your little thingy-wingies?
Yes.
Email it?
I wasn't sure.
It's not like... hard deadline, just get it to me soon.
I just didn't know if it needed like more stuff.
No. I mean, just the basic, here's kind of how I'm lining it out. And for you two guys, you saw the emails I wrote Dr. Simpson and the whole team over there. That's okay. That's all right. Well, just getting some kind of a concrete, even, you know, sit and watch the video from Monday, you know, and just like, oh yeah, that's how we talked about that and stuff. So this is good. It's just conceptualizing it. And I think, you know, the place to start right now is digging through, you know, get on Google Scholar. That's a great thing to search on. Or PubMed, if your thing has anything to do with medicine, like you two guys, there's stuff on the EGG that you'll pull up on Google Scholar and PubMed. Yours, definitely PubMed, Google Scholar. Google Scholar, you know, you might find some stuff on the Fox system. Looking in books and music index and things like that. And probably some magazines, you know, Classical Singer, Opera News, things like that.
Periodicals,
yes.
Maybe even dissertations.
Yes. There could be some. Absolutely. Dissertation abstracts online, that'd be a good place to look. So let's do this next one. That's a boy one. Well, okay. You guys.
Oh, because it's in base club. I could sing that.
Well, we can move it up a little bit, okay? So let's try it maybe up an octave. Students. I mean, Dr. Allen, with her guys, she still demonstrate right in that octave.
She always demonstrates.
And she almost always does there anyway. And I often demonstrate things down simply because I'm demonstrating a concept or a pattern rather than a particular sound. If I want them to get a particular sound, I will go ahead and sing it, you know. But typically, if you just need to transmit the idea, then just show them the pattern in a comfortable range. The more you teach, you know, I mean, my gosh, if you're teaching 6, 7, 8 lessons in a row.
Yeah, well, you gotta be careful.
You gotta be careful how much you give. Okay, so let's talk about what we got here. Let's talk about the pattern. Let's start with the pattern. What's the pattern?
Triplets.
Triplets.
Arpeggiated triplets.
So it's more disjunct, right? Because they're further apart, and it's an arpeggio pattern. Cool. How did it feel as you did that pattern? I mean, just kind of feeling-wise in your body.
You've got to make some fast transitions. That was something I was thinking about when we were up there. I was like, the vowel change is very, I don't know, is abrupt. Going from the open to the close to the open.
Yeah.
You really have to try to make it look that open.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
You have to have that constant pressure all the way through.
Legato, absolutely. It's the steady connection. And what about the direction of the pattern? What is that, you know, and the triplet feel?
It's a wide range.
It's an octave range. Do you feel like it would help someone sing out a little bit because it covers an octave and it's arpeggiated?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because you have the security of going down, oh, I like this, and
yeah,
then going back up.
It's a little bit of a slingshot, yeah? You know, it kind of sweeps the person along a little bit, which is a good thing with guys very often. We will have a day where we talk about the trouble with boys. That giving them patterns that kind of the way the pattern is structured with triplets and arpeggios and things like that, it just kind of helps them roll along. That's why you hear, I love to give guys, young, like high school guys and stuff like that, or even, you know, early undergraduates, especially guys I think that are kind of baritones but really need to be move up slowly to tenor. A song like "Oh What a Beautiful Morning," because the refrain, "Oh what a beautiful morning," the whole melody is this arpeggiated rolling along thing, and I can play that in any key, and it's like, okay, hey, let's try to this key, and I'm actually vocalizing the guy, but it's from the standpoint of a phrase from a song. Okay, so it just kind of sweeps him along. Another composer who has melodies like this, who can you think of? German.
Schubert?
Schubert might write something like this, but Brahms especially.
Okay.
Brahms especially, you know, the triplet thing and the sweeping you through. There are some of the, some of Die Schöne Müllerin, there's, Die böse Farbe, dum da 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 da, and you know, and there's also a Winterreise. There's a couple of songs that have these sweepy arpeggios and things. So patterns like this are really good for guys. Let's talk about the vowels.
Back, forward, back.
Yeah, we have back, forward, and back. And what did I put in front of the first back one?
Glide, which is sort of front. It's
yeah, so go slow down a y-glide, and what does it become?
E.
Yeah. Yeah, so you're starting him with an E position. What would that do to his tongue on that O vowel?
Keep it from choking him.
That's right, it's going to bring his tongue forward. So If he tends to go, you know, you say, okay, here we're going to go, yo. And he'll go, wow, that feels so much better. And you just go, good, all right, let's stay with that. And if he really likes to get dark on the ah, you could have him do yo, yay, ya. You could put a yo in front of each one of them. Okay? So this isn't magic or brain surgery. It's just thinking about, well, what could I do to set the singer up for success by consonants or vowels or the pattern or, you know, whatever. You're just trying to find those ways to help the right thing happen instead of me going, now, Melissa, your tongue goes back on an O. You got to keep that tongue forward, okay? You got to keep that tongue forward. I want you to stand right in front of the mirror, and if it doesn't go...
She was like, hold your tongue. Yes. And I was like, I'm a failure.
Yes. And your tongue is going, I don't want to be out here.
Uh-huh.
So instead, a little more singer-friendly approach.
I think we also tried sticking a cough drop on my tongue.
Oh.
At one point, I was singing an exercise, and she was like, here. And she just thought, hi, 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 hi.
Well, it's one thing if it's a self-extension. I've got video, Barbara Dosher teaching pedagogy class. We'll watch it at the end of the semester. It's one thing if it's you're deciding, okay, I'm just going to hang my tongue out and sing, you know, fine. But if holding it, because the tongue is like fighting all of a sudden. So now that person feels like their tongue is like 50 feet long. And they're tensing up.
I went through a phase where I became so aware of my tongue that I like literally felt like I was choking on my tongue for like a whole week straight.
Uh-huh.
I was just so aware of it.
Uh-huh.
Like,
aware is one thing, but paralyzed is another.
Yeah.
We don't want to be over-paralyzed about parts.
Could that also pull your hyoid bone up?
Uh-huh, if you pull it too vigorously.
Raise your larynx?
Yep, it sure could. So, you know, again, there's that Goldilocks spot of not too pulling it out and not too retracted, but we're trying to find freedom so that it's free to move and we get our best sound. So the pattern, arpeggiated, descends, ascends, descends. We've got back, front, back on the vowels, but yet we've got that y-glide in there to kind of keep it from getting too woofy. Good rule of thumb. If a singer is too dark, you put a yug light in front of things. If they're too bright, you put a wuh. So if they are really like this all the time and they just, everything is just so spread, you could say, okay, we're going to go wah, 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 way, 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 way. We're going to put a wuh in front of everything until it kind of comes back to the midline and, you know, these are just little tricks you can do. Okay?
And that one's W is an O, right?
You know, it's an ooh.
Whoop.
Yeah. Another handy thing about the wook glide and the yug glide is they tend to make onset easier. Things where our mouth is more closed, lip trills, the straws, humming, the really closed vowels tend to make it easier for us to have voice onset. Just another little thing. Okay, this is a good one. Okay, so we're doing. Okay, give it a shot.
Do you want
Well, yeah, because we built it in, right?
Which is nice.
We had oo on the bottom because, you know, we're down lower. You don't want to be so wide open. But then we put open vowels on the top. Sounds like this vocal lease is probably for...
Females.
Exactly. Because guys don't want... You don't want your guys going... Unless they're, like, belters or something.
It looks like it also helps with onset.
Right. It's working on onset because you're doing those little bounced little things. Now, if you have somebody who really likes to overpressurize, they're going to go, ooh, ah, they're going to punch. So what would you do for that person instead? Huh?
Make it louder.
Exactly. Take the bounces out and just have them do, ooh, ah, because they're going to overpunch staccatos and bounce things.
What if they punch that top note of your of the legato phrase?
Ooh, ah, yeah. Well, you can do some things... You might could do some body stuff, you know, like some flowing things with their arms or their body. Or you might have them say, okay, I want you to start and diminuendo on the way up. Something like that, you know. They may not be able to because they may just really want to drive it. And so then you have to, you know, do some other finagling. But let's talk about this pattern. Okay, so we've got... More closed vowel at the bottom, more open vowels for the higher parts, and then back to the closed. So it's building in that natural thing that we want to have happen with our female singers, that they're not so blowing wide open on the bottom, and that they learn, oh, I got to open up when I go up high. The little bouncy things, yeah, it's working onset. What did you feel breath-wise as you did it? You want to try it again? Ooh, right there. Ooh. So what do you feel breath-wise?
Bounced.
Yeah, it's just like springy, buoyant kind of thing.
Yeah. I don't feel like even though we stopped, I didn't feel like the support stopped.
Right, it's just like doink, doink, doink. Yeah, yeah. Okay, so it's a good onset exercise. It's a good breathing thing. Think about how many times in soprano literature you've got to do a little, you know, you're the fickle little soprano, and you go, aha, aha, you know, or you're like, devieni non tardar, where you've got arpeggiated patterns that you don't want to punch the top note for. Yeah? Okay, anything else you see there? What kind of vowels?
All back.
All back, yep, all back.
So, if we, could we change the vowel to make this a man?
Oh, absolutely, absolutely.
And then what would we
do? Well, I will do it, oftentimes I'll do it, ah and o, or ah and u, or ah and e, right? Going through my passaggio, I'll do ah, u, and ah, e.
Okay.
And then up high, I would probably do ah, o, and ah, a. Yeah.
Why closed? I can't remember. Why do we close the passaggio?
Well, we're trying to get over that second harmonic lining up with the first form. We're trying to use a low enough vowels so that they're not doing that because they're going to stay heavy, you know. That would be belting, you know, if they opened, they would kind of be going the belt route. I mean, at least an unsophisticated guy would, you know. An unsophisticated. And sometimes a sophisticated one on a bad day. So, okay. And the H is there just to make sure that they're not glottaling. Now, say you had somebody who palate likes to droop. Well, you could have them do it da, do, da, da, da. You could use a plosive. Or, you know.
Would a th do?
TH, yeah. Thu, tha. Barbara Dosher was very fond of using the TH I think she overused it some, and I told her so, and she said, and no, and she's like, yeah, you know, too much of a good thing, John, you know. She did like to use the unvoiced consonants, the unvoiced fricatives a lot, and they have their purpose, but they're not the only thing. And I think one of the ways my teaching has changed is that I use different consonants, rotate them around all the time. Okay, shall we go on? You're starting to get the swing of this. I'm loving it. Okay. Then show the eyes.
Oh my God, that could be an exercise.
Okay, here, that's supposed to be a va there at the beginning, so it's va. And as you can guess, with the bass clef, it is. But you guys can sing it here. We'll do it on the octave. Okay? Give it a try. Timbre that is more like their own, and the laryngeal activity is more like theirs. So, okay, so let's talk about the pattern. Arpeggio, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Just a good old arpeggio. And, you know, just to keep the guy awake, yeah, every once in a while you might throw in a minor instead of a major.
Mm-hmm. See, that is interesting. I don't think I have ever done that.
Oh, yeah.
And I don't know that I could do it very easily.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Kathy was working on Schließe mir die Augenbeide by Alban Berg. There's a tonal, very like late romantic version of that text. And then he did a 12-tone row version. And you can perform the pieces back to back. So you hear the same text. And the first one is just Schließe mir die Augenbeide. It's this very like Mahler-esque kind of sounding. And then the other one is obviously a 12-tone row. And she used to vocalize on that row. So she knew that row just backwards and forwards. So, you know, I've done, you know, like working on Debussy, vocalize on whole tone scales. You know, I was doing some music Dr. Ballantyne wrote, and he had all these octatonic things. So I vocalized on octatonics. You know, it's like, okay, I need to incorporate that pattern into my brain and my throat. Okay, you know? Vocalize on the modes, all the church modes. If you're going to go into early music, that would be a very smart thing to do. So anyway, on that digression, so we got an arpeggio. And what about that there V thing at the beginning?
It's a voiced.
Voiced. Fricative.
Fricative.
So just stay on that V for a second. Makes your lips all tickly, doesn't it? But things that make our lips all tickly are really great to give that person that. Okay, start forward and kind of snarly bright, right? If you're working with a guy who likes to on the bottom, you know, you give him something like zah or that, and he's like, oh, hey, that really brightens it up. And you, yeah, good.
I love having those moments with my students where I like figure something out and they look at me like I'm crazy. I'm like, no, trust me, try it.
Trust me, I am a professional. Well, or I worked with this, you know, blues rock singer that I told you guys about. And I give him, you know, like a little vocalise, and he's got a E or something on the high note, you know. And I'll say, how was that? And he's looking at me like I'm the second coming, you know. And he's like, that's so easy. I'm like, yeah, well, it's just physics. It's okay, you know. Here, we're just rolling with it. Okay, so you got front vowel, back vowel. So what's that going to do for that back vowel up there? Not too woofy, exactly. Yeah, because you've all heard male singers that when they get into their top, it sounds like a ooga all of a sudden, you know? It's like, okay, there's a fog bank coming in. Yeah. So you just don't want him getting too woofy there, right? Yeah. Anyway. Yeah. World's anchor on the left, yeah. So, and again, we've got a sweepy pattern, right? So this lets him roll up and come back down. And I think for all singers, but especially your male singers, they're going to do a whole lot better when they're learning how to get higher if they can just kind of roll up and touch it and come back down. And the same is true when you're picking their rep, finding things that kind of sweep them through higher stuff without them having to sustain the tessitura first. One of the old Italian songs that I love, if the guy's Italian diction is good, che fiero questo me da leggero, because the whole song, it, you know, they get all thinking about all the patter of the diction, and they're forgetting that they're actually kind of getting to sweep over this high note, you know? Because the bulk of the song doesn't sit that high. But every once in a while, he kind of throws you over a high note. Composers that are really good for your male students, just right off the top of my head, Brahms, Michael Head, some Schubert, some Schumann, Tosti, and Donaudi. Donaudi. And see, the thing is, Donaudi and Tosti were both voice teachers.
Is that why the, is it?
I mean, it's the, and it's the quintessential legato song, you know? Right, it's a beautiful song. One of the more famous ones of the Romantic period. Michael Head and Tosti, and I don't know about Donaudi, but I know Tosti was the composer and voice teacher for the British royal family, for Victoria. Yeah, Queen Victoria. Yeah, nice little gig he had. So he lived in London for a bunch of his life, but he was very well known as a singing teacher. And Righini and Tosti and Michael Head all did teaching. Michael Head he popularized a lot of his own songs, accompanying himself on the piano, on the radio, and stuff. Yeah. So, anyhow, those are good composers to think of when you're going, and Doherty, Celia's daughter, Doherty, some of those sea chanties and things like that, those are good things. Okay. Any other things we want to say about this? There's one other little thing we could bring up. And it refers to that O on the top. Your mouth is in that shape right now.
I feel like it has something to do with the
palate. It's actually more about mouth shape. So everybody...
Does it do anything to the forehead?
Yeah, so just... Go through the vowels. What's your mouth do on that O? Rounds.
Yeah.
What do you see male singers do as they go in their passaggio a lot? Round. Because by rounding their mouth, they're lowering first formant, they're lowering all the formants, and it's helping them kind of flip over that one and start that second formant tuning thing. So
add that bouncy voodoo.
Yeah.
To it?
You could do it bounced. You could do it bounced, and in fact, with different vowels, with different vowels, I'll use this pattern bounced with sopranos and mezzos. You know, I mean, it's just an arpeggio. It's not like I own the copyright. So. Okay. Oh, here's a soprano one, if ever there was.
I would like this one.
All right, so the pattern is up. You could take a pattern like that, and you could have a singer do it staccato, and then legato. I would recommend a breath in between, but I have heard people do bump 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 and do it legato after. John Sutherland, I'm sure, practiced it that way. But yeah, you're just going up on the tonic triad, and you're coming back down on the dominant seventh. So let's talk about staccato. What goes on when we do staccato, like this? So we're going make sound and then
no sound
and then change pitch. So we're changing the length of our vocal folds and then make sound, and you're having to adjust while you're not phonating. So it's a lot of brain to throat coordination. Can you see why we would do staccatos like this later in the vocalizing?
Yeah.
And that doing staccati accurately is a fairly sophisticated task. So when I first start with, you know, say I've got a high school sophomore, junior girl, you know, and she comes in and we're doing lessons and stuff, you know, we might do and that gets real groovy, and we do, you know, and we might do we're doing triads, then and we gradually build out longer and longer patterns. But I want to make sure, okay, that idea of adjusting pitch while you're not singing, because that's the real challenge with staccato, like this. So it's really, you know, it's like a aerobic workout there for your little muscles and your larynx, because you're doing pitch change and onset offset at the same time. So that's pretty sophisticated stuff. That's that, you know, little bit of spin drop shot, you know, in the left-hand side, you know, if you're playing tennis, that's going to drop right there when your opponent is backcourt, you know. You know, that's pretty sophisticated stuff. Most of us is like, get the ball over the net and make sure it's not in between the white lines, you know. Okay. Staccati. Anything else could we say about the pattern? It is a wide old range. It's an octave and a half. Now, what happens if you get a student who does this? Which is not common. Typically, they'll do this. They'll accent that one. Because rhythmically and harmonically, that's the one. Daughtry used to use this pattern. And in fact, my wife had a hard time getting into whistle. She really has a hard time getting into whistle. And she took the cold turkey approach. Because oftentimes to get into whistle, if you've got a full head voice, you have to close your mouth slightly to get into whistle. Again, you're trying to get past that first formant thing. And she said, okay, Kathy, you got a pencil there somewhere? And Kathy pulls out a pencil. She goes, good. Okay, now do it again.
Yeah!
But by keeping her small, you know,
yeah.
And then once she got her up like to E flat or something like that, she says, okay, now take the pencil out, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And then they did it again, and she said, okay, you can let your voice start to fill back out as you come back down. Yeah, it's a trick.
This summer, our teacher, when she was trying to teach me how to get into whistles, she just had me.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Like, I was like,
yes.
And then,
yep.
Like, it was an octave line.
Yeah, Connie Cucuro at Indiana uses that very exercise because a friend of mine studied with her. And she'd have them doing, you know, and she'd just have them flipping down. If you know the vowel tricks, you can get people in and out of a different register. It's like, okay, well, if I want to get them into the next higher register, close them, you know? If I want them to sing more full, give them a more open vowel. If I want them to sing more full out, give them a nice sweepy arpeggio. If I want them to lighten up, maybe a little more bouncy kind of pattern. So if you start thinking about, well, what am I asking those muscles to do? Then you can start tweaking the knobs a little bit. All right, let's see. There's a couple more, but we're gonna need to go here. Mezza di voce, we all know it and love it. Can't live without it. Oh yeah, this one's all consonant articulation.
Nope.
Wanna try that one?
Ma
be da me ni po tu. Try it.
La be da me ni po tu.
So you got all sorts of different kinds. Uh-huh. All sorts of different kinds of consonants and stuff there. There's another one. Anyway, that's another one. Okay. Boop. That was an old PowerPoint. And I retreaded it. Okay. So. With that thing from the Oxford Handbook that I handed out, there's some stuff in there. Motor learning, organization of practice, okay? So it's on page 11 of it. And some of the things from like sports science, overloading, specificity, individuality, reversibility, please take a look at that. And then this next section about motor learning, that's talking about different types of structuring practice or feedback. That's really important stuff, and we will pick up there. So, on Monday, we're going to talk through that. And I will give you an assignment about vocal leases where you will have some. Well, no. Just what we were just doing, where here's a pattern, what's going on? Look at the vowels, look at the consonants, look at the direction, look at the, is it arpeggiated or a scalar, or does it go down, does it go up? You know, and the best thing you can do is sing it a while, feel, okay, well, what's it feel like when I do that? What do I have to do? You know, what is this exercise kind of directing me towards? What's it feel like as I do that pattern of vowels or consonants? Because those sensations, I know you know, last semester and so on, this gets very nerdy and physiological, but what you feel is very important because you're trying to give your students the right sensations while they're in there with you, and you, like the swan on the water, have your feet going because you're going, okay, sounds like he needs to lighten up a little bit. Hey, let's walk around while we do that. Or, you know, okay, sounds like she needs to close at the bottom. Hey, let's put an E there at the end of that vocal lease. Or, you know, or sounds like he kind of peters out at the end of the pattern. He's not keeping his breath energy going. Okay, we're going to bounce. You know, so da 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 da, give him something to do past the end. So in your head, you're going, okay, analyzing what you're hearing, what do I know? Okay, good. And then we change the pattern. Or we, hey, let's try this vocal lease, you know? You guys are doing really well with starting to pull those things apart. So I think you can do this. Okay, so Monday, we will talk about the motor learning stuff and how we structure practice. And I'll give you that handout, that assignment and stuff. Okay?
Okay.
Okay. And we're done. Bye, Dorothy.
Bye.
Oh, that was silly.